the average Nvidia employee is worth over $10 million. Don't believe me? Well, let's do the math. Unlike most of big tech where employees churn out every 2 years, Nvidia's employees are pretty tenured. In fact, the average manager at Nvidia has been there for 15 years. Even if we assume that they had an entry-level software engineering job the entire time, they would have earned about $24,000 per year in stock. We can even assume that it was only $10,000 when they joined and they earned an average of $15,000 per year. Over 15 years, that adds up to $225,000 worth of stock. Not a bad amount itself, but wait until we account for stock growth. Over the past 10 years, Nvidia stock has grown 200x, so even if this employee only held on to less than half of their stock grant over the years, or about $100,000, with a 200x return, they would now have $20 million worth of just Nvidia stock, and that's being conservative. If they got a few promotions and held on to more of their stock grant, they would be closer to 30 to 50 million. And those that were able to reach upper management, like director and senior director, well, a lot of them are worth over 100 million. While these massive net worths are awesome, at the end of the day, money is only a means to an end. A means to achieve financial freedom, a means to pursue your hobbies, a means to travel the world, etc. The reality is that no matter how much you love your job and how much it pays, in the end, it's still a job. And let's just say, these engineers are reaching the point where they're not only well off or wealthy, but they've got FU money, so why not just retire? Well, that's exactly the challenge that Nvidia is currently facing. A lot of their ultra-wealthy employees have switched to coast mode or are retiring. In fact, that's what prompted me to make this video in the first place. One of my friend's dad has worked at Nvidia since the early 2000s, and with the massive recent run-up, I wanted to see what he was up to, and it turned out that he retired nearly 3 years ago. So what happens when all these engineers are rich enough to retire? The first point to note is that while these figures might seem insane from our perspective, for a lot of these guys, it's not that insane because of the extremely high cost of living at Silicon Valley. They're having to spend nearly $2 million just to get a 3-bedroom house from the 1920s. They're having to pay nearly $5 per gallon of gas, and their grocery bill is $423 per month. And let's not forget, they're only getting half of their salary to begin with because the other half goes to taxes off the bat. I think this Apple engineer puts it best. I'm not a manager, but I'm the highest tier of software engineer. Just to give you a sense of my total compensation, I pay 6 figures in federal taxes per year, and I still have to pay California tax on top of that. I'm a multi-millionaire, I own a house, I own more than $1 million worth of Apple stock, but here's the thing, it doesn't make me rich in Silicon Valley, I'm still very much middle class, the cost of life is so high. The crazy thing is that he's not even exaggerating. Statistically speaking, to be financially comfortable in San Francisco, you need a net worth of $1.7 million. To be considered wealthy, you need a net worth of $4.7 million. This is simply what happens when everyone in an area is a multi-millionaire. Being a millionaire no longer means anything, and the local costs go through the roof. Now, I'm sure a lot of you guys are saying, why not just move to a cheaper area and ball out? Well, that brings us into the second limiting factor of these stacked engineers. Even if these engineers are rich from a statistical perspective, they don't feel rich from a psychological perspective. Here's the thing, everyone they interact with on a daily basis is just as stacked, if not far more stacked. In fact, I bet there's a lot of Nvidia engineers who sold more stock than they needed to for one reason or another. And they probably get made fun of by their friends for throwing away a $20 million opportunity and only being worth $7 million instead. I know that probably sounds trivial and elitist, and it is, but I swear, that's what happens in these tech communities. Even if they didn't sell their stock and are worth $20 million, they probably interact with a manager every week that's worth 4 times as much. And they probably have a few second or third degree connections that are straight up billionaires, and all of this has a really profound psychological effect. If all of these guys around you who are worth just as much, if not a lot more, are still working their butts off, why should you retire? Well, most can never find a reason, and that brings us into the third limiting factor for these engineers, which is that they don't even care about the money. This isn't to say that they'd be willing to work for free. No, they absolutely want to be well compensated for the value they provide. But the salary itself has little to do with why they work so hard. Usually that has more to do with promotions, prestige, ego, pride, social status, you know, all that great stuff. This is precisely why most billionaires and deca-billionaires work 80 hours a week. It has nothing to do with achieving financial freedom or getting even richer. Rather, it has to do with the fact that Elon Musk is the guy who's making EVs and rockets a reality. The fact that Jensen Huang is the king of AI, and the fact that Mark Zuckerberg is the ruler of social media. These sorts of positions are extremely difficult to give up, and no amount of money will ever make them retire. The only way they eventually retire is by achieving saturation. So, what happens when all these engineers are rich enough to retire? Well, usually, absolutely nothing. Either they're not actually all that rich for their city, or they are rich but don't feel rich, or they don't even care about the money and they're playing a whole different game. Usually, it's a combination of all three of these, and as such, most of them end up putting in a regular 40 to 50 year career. They're essentially just stuck in a much bigger rat race than the rest of us, but they're still stuck in the rat race. With that being said though, there are scenarios in which these engineers get so rich that they see through this rat race, and that's exactly what's happening at Nvidia. So what happens when these engineers finally become rich enough to retire? Well, we don't have to speculate because we have examples of exactly that. Take Dell for example. The company IPO'd in 1988, and over the next 12 years, the stock would run up a staggering 1200x. For perspective, that's 6 times more than even Nvidia over the past 10 years. Naturally, this created a lot of millionaires, 2700 to be precise. In fact, there were so many Dell millionaires that they earned the nickname Dellionaires. Also, these guys weren't just worth 1 or 2 million, they were often worth tens of millions. In fact, it wasn't uncommon to receive individual stock bonuses that were worth over $10 million just due to how fast Dell stock was growing. When they initially received the grant, it was probably only worth $100,000, but by the time it unlocked, Dell stock was up 100x and suddenly your grant was worth $10 million. These types of stories were a dime a dozen at Dell throughout the 1990s, and it was even crazier than what we're seeing at Nvidia today because these guys didn't live in the Bay Area. They actually lived in Round Rock, Texas, which at the time was a quaint suburb of Austin. The average house only cost $100,000 to $150,000. Even if you wanted to ball out and buy a 5,000 square foot mansion, you could do it for less than $500,000. So what happened next? Well, moving into the 2000s, much of Dell's workforce would shift to retirement mode. Even Michael Dell would retire in 2004, giving up the title of CEO. It only took a few years of this, however, for Dell to start getting annihilated. PC demand would peak in the early 2000s, and the industry would see the rise of far cheaper Asian brands like Lenovo, Asus, and Acer. And before you knew it, Dell's profits were down 72%. How did they get through this decline? Well, it wasn't easy. Michael would come out of retirement, do mass layoffs, shut down factories, completely pivot to the enterprise market, take on $70 billion worth of debt, take Dell private, and gamble the entire company's future. I have a full video about this if you're interested, but essentially, Dell went through an existential crisis due to just a couple of years of stagnation. And the first signs of this are starting to pop up at Nvidia. A lot of tenured employees are naturally switching to semi-retirement mode. In fact, it's become a large enough issue for Jensen to hold an all-hands meeting to address exactly this. In the meeting, he jokingly called out a couple of tenured guys and basically conveyed a quote, "Do your damn job." Jensen went on to elaborate that working at Nvidia at this point was basically like a voluntary sport. It's not something that you do for the money, it's something that you do because you enjoy the job and take pride in your work. And honestly, I think this approach will be quite effective at Nvidia because Nvidia's culture is completely different from basically every other tech company. Nvidia's employees are far more tenured, have much more company loyalty, and have, quote, Nvidia pride. Also, everyone at the company basically idolizes Jensen Huang because, I mean, why wouldn't you? The guy is an absolute boss. In fact, he has a 98% approval rating. For perspective, Sundar is at 81%, Andy Jassy is at 69%, and Zuck is only at 54%. And this right here is how Jensen thinks.
I don't wake up proud and confident. I wake up worried and concerned.
This sort of mentality trickles down the entire company, and this is why you don't see Nvidia millionaires buying supercars and mega mansions. Usually, they're just liquidating small portions of their stock grant to pay off their existing house and build up larger cash reserves. It's almost as if nothing ever changed for these guys, which brings us into the reality of tech fortunes. Jensen's analogy of working at Nvidia being a voluntary sport is extremely accurate, though I wouldn't say it's a voluntary sport, but a professional sport. Professional athletes are often able to make tens of millions or even hundreds of millions per year, but their careers are usually extremely short. It's the exact same thing with these ultra-rich engineers. Their careers aren't short, but the amount of time that they can actually earn these insane compensation figures is. Sure, they hit it big with Nvidia and made 30 million over the past 10 years. But what are the chances that they can do it again over the next 10 years? Even if they did really well at their jobs and went from making $200,000 per year 10 years ago to making $500,000 per year today, after taxes, that's not even 1% of 30 million. In other words, these guys have fortunes that they cannot easily remake. Their best bet to continue exponentially growing their wealth is simply holding on to their Nvidia fortune, which is what most of them do. Over the long term, they could cross 100 million if Nvidia goes to 10 trillion, but they could also just as easily go down to 15 million. And given that these guys are savvy engineers as opposed to clueless athletes, they're extremely cognizant of that reality. And that's why most of them choose to act like nothing ever happened. Remember that friend's dad that I was talking about? Well, what I didn't mention was that he was in his late 50s before he retired, so while he did retire early, it's not like he retired in his 30s or something. Also, he lives in a $500,000 house that he bought for 200 grand 20 years ago, and he drives around in 10-year-old Acuras. So what happens when all these engineers become rich enough to retire? Well, absolutely nothing, because most of them are too smart to blow it all by doing something stupid. It seems that vanilla tech CEOs didn't quite get the memo, as they're constantly doing stupid things to appease shareholders. Check out this video to learn more, but until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.